fear of stopping that is so hard to take in our culture. The pace and the mood that we live in makes talking about depression and melancholy very odd. Because we're so driven and so manic and so fast, so one of the things you don't want to be is interrupted. And you get very annoyed if you're buying something and the sales girl picks up the phone. You get into a rage. You go to the post office, you're standing in queue, and the girl turns away or the boy turns away to do something else. You get into a rage. That kind of frustration of immediacy is a manic reaction. Another one is not being tired and not being hungry. You can go on coffee and go on stimulants and keep it going and not get enough sleep. Manics don't get tired. When you watch the heroes on TV, they're not tired. They're going full blast all the time. Schwarzenegger, you don't see him lying down and taking a rest or yawning, never. Or Stallone. So they're at it. Slowness is basic to the notion of melancholia from the very beginning. Your walk and gait slows. Your legs feel heavy. Your head feels heavy. You don't retain. You don't quite get it. Everything seems either through a thick wall or comes at you very slowly, or you haven't any energy to move it. You're trapped in slowness. The feeling is, I can't. Your legs are leaden, as if the lead has sunk down. So you don't move from your chair and you don't want to get up out of bed. The second most important thing that you see all depicted everywhere is this. Your head in the hands. Then there's a dropping of muscles in the face because of what they say, the mirth reflex is lost in depression. Now, if the mirth reflex is lost, all this gets very heavy. Everything slumps. Gravity takes over. Now, we have the word gravitas, the old Latin word for gravity, sinking down, but also grave and serious and measured and stately. The manic condition is sometimes described in psychiatry as an absence of sadness. And the word sad is very interesting because it's connected to sated and satisfaction. So a sad person is also, in Old English, to be sad was to be full. So at the end of a large meal, you were sad, sated, and sad were are interwoven. Just as in French, to be grave, grave, and gravid, to be pregnant, are verbally interrelated. So there's a fullness in what's called loss or emptiness. There's something else happening inside that melancholy. Every day, every time there's a little change of any sort, something's lost. We want to change, we want to grow, but we don't want to shed and lose. Loss means losing what was, and there with that comes regret and remorse and memory, mourning and grief and things that slow you. without time for loss, you don't have time for soul. And then the losses mount up and you develop a terrible fear of the hollow places of your own soul, where you have lost or lost out.
I think melancholy brings us away from the surfaces of life. It brings us into a depth of ourselves where we are more clear to see essences and to wonder about meanings and to see beyond our immediate personal concerns. And that releases our creative impulse. It's probably no coincidence that many poets have written on melancholy. Keats and Coleridge's Dejection Ode, Milton. They find that the melancholy brings them to a place where they see more clearly the essences of life. As Keats would say of melancholy, thou dwellest with beauty, beauty that must die.
Traditional music was formed during the 17th, 18th, and into the 19th centuries. That was a period in Irish history when there was serious oppression, poverty, hopelessness, all that sort of thing. I think when people are denied the opportunity to sort of enjoy themselves, find ways of being happy, the spirit tends to turn in on itself. And people look to the intimate arts of music and singing. And in Irish music, we have this very intimate expression of darkness. The set of pipes I'm playing, the low pitch pipes, the very sound of the instrument is almost melancholic. And certainly there are particular notes on the instrument that gives me a feeling of intense longing. There is a background of sadness as well as the high spirits of the reels and jigs and stuff. When you listen to the playing of the very old traditional musicians, in their playing of the fast tunes, there is that definitely that sadness, a sort of melancholy.
Would you describe yourself as at all melancholic?
Yes. Yeah. I am. I think there's a lot of reserve in me and shyness. Yes. Melancholic, yes. Solo touring is a very solitary business. You have to spend long hours alone. It's certainly a very good way to get to know yourself and find out what you're all about. And I often find that city people are quite terrified of the idea of getting to know themselves, or, you know, being on their own. I was brought up in the countryside. And as a child, I spent quite a lot of time on my own. So I suppose to a certain extent, I've learned to enjoy being on my own. It's a sort of happy contemplation of sadness, or something weird like that. Happy isn't the right word. But it's not... It's not depression either, for me. It's a combination of. I mean, I feel I can have the two things, the two feelings simultaneously in my mind of happiness and sadness. And to me, that's something like that is melancholia.
It's kind of allowing the sadness to be around.
Yes.
Rather than running away from it.
Exactly, yes.
I think that melancholy is a natural response to certain things in life, perhaps the tragic dimension of life. It's a mood or a feeling of twilight and autumn and a reflection upon death. And as such, I think it is quite a natural response for ourselves as part of nature to feel melancholy and be in a melancholic mood. Depression, on the other hand, I think is different in that it's a feeling of weight and burden. You're pressed down, you're down into the earth without the feeling of knowing where you might come up again, that the hope has gone, the feeling of a way out is lost to you.
It is useful to realize that there are very normal conditions which are depressing. It's an accompanying symptom to being a young person, 14, 15, 16 years old. There are moments of severe sadness and depression and loneliness and being removed and having no words and being unable. Then there's also depression that is simply a normal reaction to certain changes in life and can leave you in a very seriously deprived and inhibited condition, although it's not psychotic. It's a reactive depression to loss, to death, to war, to tragedy of some kind or another. Then there are psychiatric depressions where a person is, in a sense, insane, that is, obsessed with feelings of poverty, remorse, disintegration of the body, feeling one's turning into stench and shit and decay. And sometimes I think there's an underlying depression in our culture, which makes me think that if you're not depressed, you're abnormal, because the soul knows about the trees that are destroyed, the buildings that are destroyed, the ugliness that is spreading, the chaos of the culture in many ways. And somehow, if you're not in mourning for what's going on in the world, you're cut off from the soul of the world. So in that sense, I would think an underlying depression is a kind of adaptation to the reality of the world.
Take a line through mood. Most of us vacillate, go up and down. We get what we call the blues and unhappiness, and we get joy. The bipolar manic depressive soars both ways. It goes uncontrollably up and indeed uncontrollably down.
What does the low part feel like? Are there images you can associate with it?
Well, I'm a writer, so I always associate word images. I mean, I believe words are images. There's a piece at the end of Conrad's Heart of Darkness, which is a quote from T.S. Eliot, which just says simply, the horror, and that's what depression's about. I'm talking about blackness. Of course, we all have great sadnesses and losses, but clinical depression, psychiatric illness, aren't that. as something else. I really believe that. And it's a curse. It's a curse. I mean, it is. I actually think most creative people are cursed in their own way. They're driven. They're obsessive. Things take over their lives. So you actually have to make use of what you are and what you have and what affects you in life. So you have to try to look for any positive side of it. And there are not positive sides, that's the wrong word to use, but there are moments in that despair which are quite beautiful in a strange sort of way. It gives you tremendous insights. People often say that depressives and manic depressives are people without one layer of skin. Strange enough, as a writer, I've been much more influenced by painters than I have ever been by other writers. One being Edward Munch, because he was a man who made beauty out of despair, total despair, and for a man to produce on canvas a sort of frightening beauty that he produced means he must have dug down very deeply into his soul. And I think that's what you have to do as an artist. I really do think you have to lay yourself bare. I've had 60 psychiatrists in my life over 40 years. Only one has had an experience of depression. You know, their words are very vacuous. This is what I said about words. They use words very easily. You know, you sit on a table with a psychiatrist and there's two folders as thick as that, your life between brown paper covers. It means bugger all. It means nothing. They don't understand.
The very deep prejudice is why when someone falls into a depression, everyone comes to resurrect them in every possible way, reenacting the myth of the culture. And that myth says, you may be melancholic, you may have a terrible Good Friday, still it only takes 2 days to be resurrected. There's light at the end of the tunnel. Cheer up, things will be better. Get up, get out, get going. And we find drugs and we find convulsive therapy and we find whatever else. And in order to avoid it in our normal life, we just get up and go jogging, put on our Walkman, and get out. Move. Move, man. Keep moving.
Lots of people who run, when you ask them, look, why do you run? Virtually no one says they do it for health. When you do vigorous exercise, endorphins, natural opiates, opium-like substances are released in the brain, and that's what makes you feel good. I run because I enjoy it. But I think it is a way of dealing with anxiety and minor depression, certainly. And also, if I don't run or do some sort of quite vigorous exercise, I certainly feel worse and feel rather low. I think there's a tremendous amount of what I think of as psychobabble, which relates to our emotions. I basically believe that nobody understands how the brain works, and particularly when you come to things like depression, I'm deeply suspicious that any of it is well-founded. So if you say I'm running away from my depression, yes, if you want to say that. And I think it's a very cheap way of doing it. It's much cheaper than psychotherapy. And indeed, in the literature now, it's quite widely reported that for mild depression, vigorous exercise may be a very sensible, at least first approach. If you think of it from an evolutionary point of view, depression is bad news. I know on a few occasions I've been really depressed, then you're immobilized. And I think that when man, women were evolving, to be depressed gave you a great disadvantage and your chances of survival were lower. So I don't think it's a natural phenomenon. I think it's a disability being depressed.
Thank you.
culture, which is very struck by speed and is encapsulated in the car, which we spend most of our money on. And it exhausts. You can't keep up like that. And then you just have to come down because there's no other place to go to. I'm not suggesting, therefore, it's much better to be low. But when you are low, you see the other side of the coin, if you like. And the first part of my work is enabling people to identify that feeling. Usually people will come in and they're expecting something from you. So you say, well, there's a piece of paper, there's some materials, perhaps you might like to use the colours in a way which you feel might be relating to your experience at the moment. It's quite surprising that people will feel quite stuck, but as soon as the paint flows, they seem to flow.
So you're becoming quite aware of when your paintings are going off the boil, as it were, and they're losing their life, and you want to stay with the activity.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Otherwise they lose the point.
How do you feel about that colour area in the...
I think it's absolutely beautiful. But I'm amazed by it because it doesn't seem to be something I've created.
Depression seems to be a disguised form of anger. I think there are other ways of looking at it, but that's the model that I work with. And you see it so often in paintings painted as black, usually in the first instance. There are other ways, but black is the most common one. And some people will say that is their anger. As the paintings proceed, red is very frequently the next colour that comes through. And whilst red you could see as it's a very vivid, strong, alive, exciting colour, but when you see it next to black, people almost always describe it as anger.
You've got these areas coming in and threatening your centre. Mm-hmm. What I wanted to clarify was exactly what this was coming in. It seems quite large, and this looks quite small. This is full of colour.
It's really the world.
It's the world.
All the pressures of the world.
Yeah, coming in on you in the centre.
That's right, yes.
From all directions, including this top and
bottom. Yes, oh yes.
So it's all coming in on you.
Yes.
So how is that leaving you feeling right now?
Very vulnerable.
Right.
It's at times like this that I doubt my strength to fight them back.
Well, I'm not surprised.
I feel that people, whether they've learned it in childhood or whether there's something just come up upon them like a bereavement or something like that, they've somehow become discouraged in expressing that feeling. And as they are discouraged, disheartened or whatever, so it's as if the redness in them, their life, their vitality has gone down. And what is left? If your life energy is no longer flowing out, what are you left with? And that's when the darkness seems to come in.
When we are depressed, we lose our imagination. One's lost the capacity to imagine anything different from what is. And one's lost the fire and the heat and the warmth and the excitement of the imagination, which goes where it will, after all. It isn't something, thankfully, that's totally in our conscious control. You could say it's that which unites our unconscious and our conscious life. And trying to open the way for it to come back in any form it pleases is one of the readiest ways to lift a depression and be returned to life. pre-scientific times, melancholia was thought to belong to one of the four temperaments. The world and the people in the world were seen as having one of four temperaments, choleric, sanguine, phlegmatic, or melancholy. And so you didn't view melancholy as such an affliction as we would today. There was a sense that you were participating with the rest of the universe in this, that it wasn't peculiar to you to feel or be melancholy. The universe itself was melancholy in some of its aspects, just as it was choleric and sanguine and phlegmatic. Melancholics were believed to be born under the sign of Saturn. And Saturn was the planet or the god particularly associated with lead for the alchemists and with time in his godly aspect. Saturn came to be associated with the constraints that time puts upon us, so in old age and death, and then that was extended to the other limitations, such as sickness and even the personal limitations, when we can't do what we want to do, or we want what is too much for us to do. In that sense, Saturn was often contrasted with Jupiter, which gave us the sense of infinite horizons, whereas Saturn reminded us that we have boundaries and limitations in which our human condition is set.
I'm speaking of depression in one form or another as a necessity of the soul for its downward and inwardness, and for the discovery of gods that are not present in other places. What the Greeks called Hades, who is also another name for him, was Pluto. Now, Hades was invisible, so you couldn't, that's one of the reasons you can never see through your depression. You can never see why you have it, because if Hades is behind it, you can't see him. It's impossible to recognize what it is. And Pluto, the other name for Hades, means riches. And one of the reasons they said the souls never came back from the dead or from the underworld was that conversations with Hades were so interesting that no soul ever wanted to leave the underworld, suggesting that there is a depth of reason, a depth of images, a depth of fantasy there that you may only get to through depression. Because of the Christian elimination of the underworld, turning it into hell, we're left with just a hellish experience. It is so important not to resurrect the old ego, but to resurrect the old traditions. The animal images for depression, the images of different heroic figures who went down, the images of female figures. So they had a wealth of understanding of the states of the soul that we have eliminated in our scientific approach, as if it had to do with only with physiological or glandular or neurochemical or constitutional factors. Importance of the gemstones that they had in the Middle Ages, in the Renaissance. For example, they thought that the blue color in sapphires came from a mixture of Venus and Saturn. That's how you got the blue color. Now, that's beautiful. That's telling you that beauty and sadness, that restriction and constriction and sensitivity go together. And that produces a blue color. And the blue stone we have the blue moods. We have blue music, blue jazz.
Now my room has got two windows, but the sunshine never comes through. You know it's always dark and dreary since I broke off, baby, with you. I live on a lonely avenue. My little girl wouldn't say I do.
Between blue and black. In alchemy, the blue is the blackening moving towards the lightning, that is, towards lightening and opening out again. But it's still associated with the black in the sense that as blues music is no longer just blocked, inhibited, it's the song of the black. It's the black breaking into lament, into complaint. It's opening the heart, opening the soul. And that's the black beginning to move or soften. Turning of the black into the blue, the shift in mood, happens also with humor. There's also black humor. The humor of the depression quality of slow, bitter, ironic, seeing the underside. Why that's important is that you don't have to take depression literally. What black humor does is make a joke about itself. Why is humor touch that? Why are the clowns so sad? What sadness of the world does the clown present? So there is a movement within melancholy, within depression, that you can enter the world as a melancholy. Not enter the world as a manic in order to escape it, but you enter the world, you bring to the world the blue music, you bring to the world the black humor. And you're still a depressive. You're still feeling that weight of soul, but you go on with your life in another way.
There's a Sumerian myth where Inanna from the light world, the queen of heaven, goes down into the underworld to see her sister, the dark queen, Ereshkigal. It's a myth which shows the importance of bringing the light world into contact with the dark world, actually losing the light, going into the dark, and coming forward again. And she has to sacrifice her seven veils, in fact, seven gateways she has to go through, disrobing at each gateway, and then in the end she's simply a naked corpse. But the point is that she intensifies her feeling of depression. She goes deep into the earth to face this terrifying other who she knows not, but who is part of her, given as her sister. And in this, there is a reevaluation taking place. She knows the underworld, she knows the depths to which she can descend, and she also chooses to come back. She knows also that she does not want this as a permanent state. And so there is a reconciliation of light and dark, of upper and lower worlds. There is, in the end, a rebirth from the death. But it's been by intensifying the experience.
What I feel is that when I'm perfectly all right and up and getting on with things and so on, it seems that to me as if I'm living with a sort of a curtain, a kind of shimmer in front of myself that is shielding me from what I can see and what I know. And I suppose, yes, I suppose there are moments when you write when that gets pierced. You see, I think what there is to write about is what you can hardly bear to think about.
There was no doubt she was depressed. Probably what Davis back in the hospital would have called clinically depressed. It felt like that top layer of skin had been removed and suddenly the depression was exposed to the air. Yes, that was it, as if she'd been skinned. Late at night, when the visitors had gone and doctors were safely at home, she wept. Not the special tears that came in response to private or public tragedy, but just plain, everyday salt tears that had been queuing up quietly behind her tear ducts all day long, waiting for their moment of release. They came from a place of despair far inside her, a place where hopelessness meant precisely what it signified, that there was not a glimmer, not the faintest, meanest chance of hope. Hope for what? Nothing. Not directed hope, just none whatsoever. She felt during the times the tears had to wait because there were people to deceive, like a desert, dry, unbounded, parched, so that her skin actually felt as if it might crack from lack of moisture. No feelings of depression had ever been quite as bad as this, or quite as lacking in the prospect of termination.
There is a sort of well of sadness that's there and available and sometimes sort of can't be avoided, but also sometimes is there to go into because it's quite useful. The problem is, you know, the fear of looking at stuff, and that sort of creates a situation where one's sort of brittly jolly. But there's a terrible sense of being separate from something essential. And I find sometimes I actually have to give myself space to be private and to be sad in order to feel like me. There's a need for that. Like there's a need for food.
There was no end to her desert. Or so it seemed during the day, and on those evenings when Julian came or a colleague popped in to find out, in a normal, friendly sort of way, how she was doing. And yet, when safely alone in bed, late at night, she finally let the tears tumble, not bothering to mop them up because it didn't matter, and anyway she knew more and more would fall, something happened. A change took place. If it was a watering of her desert, it did not cause it to spring into life, but it made perhaps relieving irrigation channels, small rivulets that broke up the vastness of the wasteland inside her. There was something healing, something special that occurred, and she didn't understand it. What she got was a kind of rest, a place of retreat, in which wounds were healed and sadness transformed itself into a most particular joy, without losing a deeper sadness, which seemed to her to be essential. This sadness was global, quite unrelated to herself, and it was not a companion of pain. It was a spirit that flowed through her and made her, in those very early hours of the morning, more human than she had ever felt in her life. She gave her frame of mind the name of melancholia, which did not seem to her to be a negative word at all.
In this land of an hour, the colors might run. In this land.
Moment, without that sadness in the heart and weight that you feel, you can't be slow enough to receive or hear the beauty. So there is in melancholy a longing for something that is singing or calling or sighing through us that isn't even our own personal depression. And you can feel that in the landscape. So moods are not only my moods. And I think psychiatry again, or therapy again, misses some of that. So you put into a terrible room, in a ward or a clinic or somewhere, but you're cut off from the mood of the world, then all that mood becomes yours. Whereas you may need a landscape for to place your mood and to have response from the world to that mood, to share the mood with. Things about depression is it forces you to stay true to it. It's so leaden, it's so ununderstandable, it's so miserable, you are so limited in your ability to do anything with it, about it, that it forces that truth on you. There are all kinds of things that can feed the soul in that condition, which don't necessarily drive you deeper into your personal misery, but which enriches it. And that's what we learn from art. That's what we learn from Beethoven. Beethoven was syphilitic with his ears gone. He couldn't hear. And he wrote these incredible last quartets. So there are factors that help you carry what you have to carry. Fundamentally, everything is inexplicable. It doesn't matter what you go into. If you go into it deeply enough, you realize there is no answer, because you come to the end of reason. Probably melancholia gives you the feeling of coming to the end of reason. It affects the feeling level. It isn't merely that your mind can no longer understand what's happening to you, but you have the feeling that there is no way you can go on. And that reason itself has come to a stop, or that, as they say, time itself comes to a stop, or the mind at the end of its tether. That's its importance, though, that it stops the mind's inflation, that it can understand everything or come to grips with anything.